Hello and welcome to Honey Badger 3D Print and Paint. Today, let's take a look at the Artillery Hornet. But first of all, roll those credits. The Artillery Hornet. The printer that nobody asked for, but actually is pretty good. I'll show you the prints in a minute that have come off the machine, but let's go over some specs of the machine first. Okay, so this is inside Ender 3 territory. It is 220 by 220 by 250 on the build volume. It does not have an AC powered bed. It is a regular heated bed. There is tempered glass that has the ultra base coating on the top. I found the adhesion pretty good. With all of my ultra bases, I still use a layer of hairspray. Technically speaking, you shouldn't have to do that, but I find it works really well both as a release agent and as an adhesive. There are some obvious things that we need to take a look at, and in a little bit we'll dive into the electronics inside the machine as well, just to take a look, have a look, see what's going on. Let's talk about first impressions. Okay, so the first impression is that it's yellow. I don't know why it's yellow, but it is. It doesn't really affect the machine, it's a little odd. So if we move that out of the way, you can see the tool head that we have here. So easily the most controversial or the most divisive part of this printer is how the Bowden tube attaches. So there is essentially an S-video cable that's been hollowed out. The Bowden tube runs between this cable, and it means that you only have a single cable going to the hot end. It also stays nice and rigid and uptight, so you don't have to worry about putting an ID badge holder up the top to keep all your cables out of the way. I don't hate it. Aesthetically, very nice. My concern is that you cannot remove the Bowden tube from inside this piece here. So this just unscrews from here. There is actually filament in this, so I'm not sure if I'm gonna be able to pull this out. No, you do that. Okay, so as you can see, there is a piece of Bowden tube that sits right here. That is not replaceable. So if you need to replace the whole thing, then you are replacing the whole thing. You are replacing all of this cable piece here. As of right now, as of filming, I don't know how much that cable costs. I'd almost guarantee that I'd be unhappy with how much that cable costs, but I don't know how much that costs. You can't actually get those spares yet. It's a design choice. There is not an engineering reason or a mechanical reason as to why you would do that. They could have even made it so that the Bowden tube was removable from inside this cable, and that would have been fine because you could replace it without having to change the whole cable, which to feed it through or pull it out. But that isn't what they've done. That being said, so far, there's no wear or any sort of degradation of the tube that's in there at the moment. I've printed since our live stream pretty constantly. As you can see, I've got a few things here. I also printed some parts for mine and Mike's BLV MGN cube. Watch out for that video. And you know, and it's done a lovely job. It's doing a lovely job. It's just an odd choice. I don't really know what the sort of the purpose was. You could have designed a nice drag chain. You could have just made this tube removable. Yeah, it's a decision that was made, and it is what it is. That being said, the tool head actually prints very nicely. I will show you some up close tests on this little sort of all-in-one test that's here. By overhangs, it's pretty good on this side up to 50, and it's pretty good on this side up to about 60. It's worth noting that as of filming, again, there isn't actually a default Cura profile. So I have used my Sidewinder profile, but it shrunk down to the right build volume, and I had to play about with retraction a little bit to get it so that it's not too wispy. But I'll do some close-ups of this in a second. Dual fan blowers on the side, they do a decent job of part cooling. As I said, I'll show you the bridging test in a minute it's actually pretty good. You do have a dual drive Titan, which is on the left-hand side of the printer, and I don't really know why. So they've flipped round. Normally you would have your Titan on the right-hand side, or your X-axis motor and everything on the right-hand side. They flipped it to the left. Now, for the vast majority of people, that's not an issue whatsoever. You know, left, right, what does it matter? If you have a farm, you more than likely have your farm set up for Ender style machines, or you know, or for direct drive machines or whatever, and therefore the enclosures you will have built for your machines are built to that size to accommodate those printers, and it just means you have to flip the spool onto the other side. If you're using the integrated spool holder, then again, not an issue, you just clip it on the other side and off you go. If you've mounted one to the inside of your enclosure, just means you're gonna have a little bit of work to do to flip it around. You do get adjustable X-axis belt tensions. You do get adjustable Y belt tensions. The adjustable on the X is obviously finger adjustments. The adjustable on the Y is two screws. So you do need the Allen keys to do that. The ultra base bed heats up nice and quickly. And as I have said, I am genuinely impressed with the print quality. There are some caveats. So caveat number one is it takes a full-size SD card, not really an issue, but the SD card they give you is an SD card adapter for a micro SD. That's a weird choice. Either if you're giving me a micro SD, then make it a micro SD card slot, and if it's not a micro SD card slot, give me a full-size SD card. Like why? Why? Other than that, the spool holder is injection molded, ironically, rather than 3D printed, and works really well. It fits nicely on the machine. It lines up nicely with the Titan extruder that is on there, so the filament feeds nice and cleanly. The only caveat I would put there, really, is that if you're the kind of person who uses bigger spools, you're going to struggle to fit them on that spool holder. You can move this forwards and back a little bit. It's got a little forward and back motion, but obviously it's not got any height adjustment. So if your spool is that much bigger, it won't fit on. That being said, if you are printing in this build volume, as in, you know, the Ender 3 size 220 by 220 by 250, you shouldn't really need sort of 2.5-5 kilo spools. I run those spools on my sidewinders, and generally speaking, the prints I do never use a full 2.5 kilo, or they don't use a full 1 kilo spool for the most part. And those machines have filament sensors. This machine does not have a filament sensor. Again, for this build volume, I don't think it's that much of an issue, personally. Just means you have to estimate what you've got on there and pay attention to your print jobs. It's not really a big deal. There are a couple of quirks with the machine that could be addressed. So one of them is that when you plug the SD card in, the screen automatically refreshes itself. So I don't know whether or not anybody on the channel or watching will remember, but on older machines, when you put the SD card in, you had to go through the Marlin menu and press refresh, and that would refresh the SD card. And you would then be able to go into the SD card and see what was in there. And if you pulled the SD card out, you'd actually have to press refresh for whatever was on the SD card to disappear. This sort of automatically does that. I'm gonna call it a feature, not a bug, because it is actually helpful that you don't have to refresh, that you don't have to refresh media. That being said, not really 100% sure if that was deliberate or not. But we'll give them the benefit of the doubt and say that it is. The one feature that is missing from this that I would say is unfortunate that it's missing is power loss recovery. Now, there's a couple of reasons why that is unfortunate that it's missing. I'll be very clear that in the UK, our power is relatively consistent. It's fairly irregular for us to have power cuts. One, maybe two a year, if that. I would say, to the best of my knowledge, in the last year and a half, I don't believe we've had a power cut. That being said, I'm fully aware that some of our American watchers, there are power cuts that happen in sort of in different American cities. I appreciate that that's an issue. So not having power loss recovery is frustrating, especially because there is zero hardware requirements. You can just, it's just a Marlin enablement. So when Artillery released the firmware, I have no doubt that an industrious member of one of the groups will more than likely re-enable that and send that out to the community if Artillery don't do it themselves, which they may very well do. Another quirk is they have flipped the Z motor. So the Z motor is now at the top. If I'm willfully honest, I also can't really see too much of a reason for doing that. It just means that, generally speaking, now the motor is pulling the Z-axis up rather than pushing the Z-axis up. It is only single Z, which for a machine of this size with this weight of tool head, I don't really think is that much of an issue. Everything tightens with eccentric nuts and it tightens up nice and easily. Mine actually came pretty much pre-tightened, so it wasn't something that I had to worry too much about. There is a small breakout board that is in this tool head, and that does actually have a BL Touch fitment in there, like a BL Touch plug in there that you would be able to plug a bed leveling sensor into, and you'd be able to fit that. I don't know how the bracket would work because it's a fairly packed in tool head, so I'm not really sure where you're supposed to put your BL Touch, but theoretically you can fit one if you wanted to do auto bed leveling. All the electronics are nice and safely tucked away. You can't stick your finger in anything. They've got sort of an ABS plastic injection molded front, which is nice and sturdy, and an ABS injection molded back as well. So let's strip this thing open and take a little look at the electronics on the inside. Only three screws in this, so 1, 2, 3, and then this just pops off and we can get inside. So as you can see, we have here a proprietary Artillery board called the Artillery Ruby. You can see that we're still using the same AT drivers that they use on the regular sidewinders, which are essentially 2208s. They are silent stepper drivers, and they are actually silent, so that's very good. You can see that on here, they have put ferrules on the ends of all of their power cables. Very, very good. A lot of companies just tin their wires, and tinning is better than bare cables, but it's still not as good. Ferruling your cables shows a degree of quality control that I really look for, so that's brilliant. Everything is properly glued in though. So if you're the kind of person who tinkers or plays about, you're gonna have a bit of a mare trying to get a lot of that off, because that's not just a little bit of glue, that is the kind of people who have shares in a hot glue factory. That is an awful lot of glue on that board. To be fair, there's two pools of thought when it comes to when they put this much glue on. One is that it makes upgrading or changing things very difficult. I happen to agree. I tend to play about with my machines quite a lot. It can be quite frustrating. However, it's also worth noting that if they didn't do this, there's a good chance that during shipping, they would end up with some of those cables coming loose, and then people complain and their machines don't work on arrival. And then the other thing that is just worth noting is there is no useless warranty void if you if you remove this sticker that you get on all of the Sidewinders and the Geniuses. There's a decent amount of airflow into the case through here, which is blowing directly over the stepper motors. So that shows a degree of care put into that as well. There are a couple of expansion ports. So we've got here, this is an LED port. That is a reset switch, which no one would use. And I would imagine, so that says it's a UART port, but I'm pretty sure that's where a BL Touch might plug in, I guess. Not sure. But anyway, that's the internals of the machine. As I say, everything laid out quite nicely. You can't get to anything important. unless you take the cover off, nothing is exposed. I quite like that. So let's take a look at some prints.
Okay, so let's start with the Invisible. This is a model from Thingiverse. It came out really nicely, but as you can see, I messed up the settings in Cura and I ticked the experimental feature of make the overhangs printable, and it seems to have completely filled it in. It's actually supposed to be completely hollow, but that came out really nicely. This is a vase of Thingiverse as well. Base is really, really clean. That came off the bed really nicely. And as you can see, really consistent, really nice extrusion. It is actually watertight. I was quite impressed with that as well. Then we have the Stag Beetle from Fab365. This is a all-in-one print in one piece. And it came out really, really nicely. So all prints as one, no supports, all clips together. Really, really nice how this one came out. Well impressed with that. This is another print in place one, been liking these recently. It is an iris box that, as you can see, closes. I did it 150% scale. You cut out the little tabs underneath, and then you get a movable iris box. Very, very nice. I really like the way that the leaves came out. They sort of came out. They came out because they all print in place. They all have like different directions that the extrusion lines went, and I think the effect is really cool. So I really like that. Then we have the 3D printer test. So let's see if we can get that in focus properly. Hold on. There we go. Right, so the whole point of this test is basically so you can test overhangs, bridging, and all of that sort of stuff. So this here's your overhangs, this is your retraction settings, and then over here, this is dimensional accuracy, sorry, and then over here is your bridging. So first of all, let's take a little look at how it does on bridging. Very, very nicely. So two part coolers, one either side on the Hornet, and it's doing it really nicely. Sorry, I'm struggling to keep the camera in focus here. I really should have done this slightly larger. Then you've got the retraction tests. Then we come to overhangs. So we've got steep overhangs and shallow overhangs. You can see that it's fine up to about 50 to 60 degrees on steep, and about 60 on the short one. So I'm pretty impressed with that. That's about average. Again, dual part cooling on the Hornet. So it really makes a difference when you have proper part cooling. Means your bridging and your overhangs and everything are just going to come out a lot nicer than they normally do.
Right, so final thoughts. This is not a small sidewinder, and it's certainly not a Genius. It's an artillery Hornet. It sits a little strangely in the market, but that being said, it's objectively nicer and has more features than an Ender 3. So an Ender 3, I mean, so just when we compare this to an Ender 3. Now, there is a reality. The reason why people compare things to Ender 3s is relatively simple. A, it's a very popular printer. B, it's a very well-known printer. And C, it's a very cheap printer. So this machine, it's feature rich. It's got a lot of stuff on it. It's got a much better bed surface than an Ender 3 does at stock. It's got dual drive extruder. It's got much better part cooling. The spool holder is much better and much more sensibly placed. It's got silent stepper drivers. It's got belt tensioners. It's an objectively nicer machine. I don't think anybody would really argue that. Yellow's a little bit of an odd choice, I suppose, but who really cares what color the printer is? You know, people still bought the BitQB ones when they were like purple or whatever. So, I really like it. It prints really well. I have concerns about the Bowden tube. I have concerns about those. But those concerns, so far, haven't been validated. I've done well over 100 hours worth of printing. I've printed everything in PLA. Oh, except for this. This was printed in PETG. And I'll be honest with you, I don't see any issues. It prints really well. Things stick to the bed. It's got consistent extrusion. The dual drive Titan works really well. You know, there's some odd choices. I think everybody would agree with that. But ultimately, there's nothing really wrong with this machine. When I did the live stream unboxing, which you can check out here, and we'll pretend that I've got the editing capability to put that in. Maybe I do, maybe I don't. When I bought unboxed on the live stream, it was up and printing inside of 15 minutes. There was a calibration cube that came out of it at stock. That came out very nicely. And I haven't done anything to the machine. I haven't messed about with E-steps. All I've done is brought my Sidewinder profile in, changed the retraction, and started printing. I think there's probably, so there's quite a savage Z-seam on some of these, which again is slicer settings. And there's a good chance that the acceleration might not be quite right because I was getting a few artifacts and things on a couple of these prints. So if I slowed it down a little bit on the acceleration, I think it would perform a little better than it is now. But this is a nice machine. There's really no two ways about that. It does its job, it does what it says on the tin. I can't really fault it for the, you know, for the price and for the quality and for the features that you get. It's good. It's a good machine. On my live stream, I gave this a 7 out of 10. I'd be willing to bump that up to a 7.5. My reasons for that are: it's not an AC heated bed. It's a feature that's on both the Genius and the Sidewinder. Feels a little unnecessary to have left that out. I understand it's a cost thing, but I would have liked to have seen an AC heated bed. I'm still not sold on having this all integrated. It just doesn't sit right with me. But I'll be honest with you, other than that, it's nothing wrong with it. Not wrong with it necessarily, you know. The power resume feature being left out, yeah, a little frustrating. You know, when it's a software thing, that's a little annoying. And it's a little bit of an odd choice to give me basically the wrong SD card and then give me an adapter when you know what the machine is. But other than that, I really like it. It is really good. If I was asking for anything else to be included, it would have been, I really like the fact that you can use a USB stick on the Sidewinder. It saves me a fair amount of time. I don't have to get adapters out to plug it into my PC and blah-de-blah-de-blah. Would have been nice to have had a full USB-A port for me to plug just a stick into, but that's just a personal thing, really. So 7.5 out of 10. I think that's a solid score for a solid machine. I wouldn't go much above that unless we were starting to see linear rails, or if we were starting to see integrated drag chains, we were direct drive, we had AC heated beds, we had a non-proprietary board. I'm not really a big fan of proprietary boards personally. I prefer them to be like MKS Robins or Gen L's or, you know, SKR's or something like that, just because I know that they're cheaper to get, I know they're easier to modify. If I want to play about and tinker with it, I've got the options. I genuinely would recommend this machine to anybody who was looking to start out. It is an easy machine to get on board with. So anyway, with that in mind, guys, thanks very much for joining. Thank you very much for being a part and staying this long. We have a lot of videos coming out very soon. We have the 3D Talk Fan 260, one of the weirdest names I've ever had. And that is a Ender 3 killer. That is an astonishing little machine. So I'm really looking forward to doing that. Me and Mike have got the BLV cube that we're building and we're working on in between. We have a couple more model videos coming out. I've done a big Iron Man Hulkbuster that I'm desperate to show off to you guys. So stay tuned, keep watching, and don't forget to like and subscribe. See you later, guys. Bye.